tasked by the previous Greek government to decide the case for the reunification of the Parthenon marbles. We presented our report on the 30th of July 2015 to the current government. Nothing was heard of it since. We didn't even get a thank you. I guess the current government is not very interested in the return of the marbles. But it is firstly something I should mention. Professor Norman Palmer was the leading authority on the return of cultural property in the world. He spent the last 4 months of his working life, he died sadly last year, working on the way, the legal argument for the return under international law of the Parthenon marbles. He found a way, as did I. We think that there is a way. Our report was leaked to The Guardian, which briefly reported it, and is on some Guardian website in cyberspace. But the five conclusions that we reached was first that the marbles constitute a unique historical and cultural property of, they are the first picture of a civilization that we can call civilized. And that is enormously important for European culture. There can be no greater imperative for European culture than reuniting the marbles that are in the Dubin Gallery in the British Museum, putting them together with the other half of the Parthenon marbles under in the new museum under a blue attic sky with the Parthenon looming overhead through the transparent window. Now, that is a cultural imperative for Europe as much or separately as it is for Greece. And that's important to remember. We also studied the Lord Elgin's theft of the marbles. We concluded it was theft. He had no right to do what he did. The license that he had specifically prohibited him from ripping off great tracts of the Parthenon. And when he came to Cadge to get the British government to buy for his own profit the marbles, he lied. He lied demonstrably. He said that he'd come to Athens and he'd seen the Turks stripping the place. That was a total lie because he didn't come to Athens until after his own men, on his own instructions, had ripped the marbles from the building. As for the British, I should say our next finding was in relation to diplomacy as a way of getting the marbles back. The Greek government started its diplomatic request for the marbles in 1833. Can you believe that? 1833. And 180 years of diplomacy has not got them back and won't get them back. Anyone who thinks it will is an idiot. The next thing we found was that the British Museum has not cared properly for the marbles. There was that dreadful incident in the 1930s where they destroyed a lot of them by scouring them to make them white, not their original color, with brushes that were made of wire, carbohydrate. And of course, today, the irresponsibility of the trustees of the British Museum can be seen in the fact that the Parthenon marbles are exhibited in the Duveen Gallery, Lord Duveen being one of the worst art criminals. He's a crook. He donated, please keep quiet, he donated his money that he ripped off various art dealers to the British Museum. It is an extraordinarily irresponsible use of the marbles to use them to commemorate a criminal. And that is what the trustees have done. As far as the law is concerned, we decided that international law is developing rules against the theft in favor of the restoration and reunification of cultural property. So that a case before the International Court of Justice, Greece would have a reasonable chance of winning. Well, you can read our report on this Guardian website. What we didn't envisage, because our report was presented before it happened, was a dramatic development on June the 23rd last year. The United Kingdom voted to leave Europe. Well, it didn't actually. 37% voted to leave, 35% voted to remain, 28% didn't vote, which means 63% of the British public did not support leaving Europe. But the present view of all political parties is that the UK is leaving Europe. Fine, and let it leave the marbles to Europe. Now this is interesting. The negotiations begin in 2 weeks' time when Mrs. May presses Article 55. Britain needs a lot of favours. It wants to stay in the single market. It doesn't want to pay the 80 billion that it's run up in ventures in the future that it's approved. A fair range of other favours it wants. It will negotiate with Brussels, with negotiators from France and Germany, from the EU. And interestingly, those EU negotiations are bound by the European Union Treaty, Article 3 of which requires that they act to safeguard and enhance European cultural heritage. Article 167 of the European Union Treaty requires that they act to conserve and safeguard significant European cultural heritage. And it goes on in these terms that account must be taken of the need to preserve European cultural heritage when taking any action under other provisions of this treaty. And the other provision of this treaty is Article 50. So the EU negotiators, in my view, are bound to put the return of the marbles on the negotiating table. And that must be the message that goes out from the Greek press to the presses in Bonn and Paris and Brussels. That must be the way in which, with the Parthenon marbles on the negotiating table, Britain can be required, forced to return them, and perhaps will give them back willingly, because most opinion polls show that the British people, the majority of them, want the marbles to go back. And it is mainly the trustees, the Philistine trustees of the British Museum, who want the marbles to remain to the glory of Lord Devine, the art forger and crook, to enable this silly idea of Neil McGregor's is now left, that the British Museum is entitled to be a something for everyone museum, a quick, cheap thrill as you pass from the marbles to the Egyptian mummies via the Isle of Lewis Kessler. So, it could be a win-win situation. The Brexit negotiations do what the European Union treaty requires the Brussels negotiations to do, and to consider safeguarding European cultural heritage, and thus make the price of British entry to the single market, or whatever favours they do for Britain, the return of the Parthenon marbles to the new museum. So that must be the message, the new possibility prospect that is open. Put the unification of the marbles on the Brexit negotiating table.
Ladies and gentlemen, my dear friends, I'm delighted to welcome you all to the 5th annual dinner of the Greek Press Association. I'm pleased to see so many friends here tonight. The aim of the Greek Press Association is to bring together Greek, Cypriot and British journalists and to develop a strong and productive Anglo-Hellenic cooperation. As we are not far from the Greek street in Soho, may I remind you that the first Greeks arrived in London in 1660. Among them was Dr. Rodokanakis, who was personal physician to King Charles II. The community established the first Greek church, which was to give its name to Greek Street in Soho. The church has long gone, but the name Greek Street remains. We welcome Mrs. Marina Giannakoudaki, former member of the European Parliament. Hello, Marina. The representatives of the new and old Greek societies in London. Mr. David Wilson at Michael's Table, a film and TV producer, director of the Delphi program in 2010 with Michael Scott in BBC, which has been repeated 25 times. Now his new series, UK Rivers, is on TV with Jeremy Paxman. Also, David has done another series on Greek drama and is repeated now this month on BBC 4. Professor William St. Clair, well-known historian and author. Hello, sir. And Tom Holland, another well-known author, was supposed to be with us tonight, but his flight from Spain was cancelled. We hope to see him next year. Victoria Hislop is among us. She's very popular in Greece and everywhere. She came, in fact, from Greece last night. Her books have been translated in 30 languages. Her latest book is here. It's Card Postals from Greece. Stavros Danaos was supposed to be here with us, but he had to stay in BBC, his famous weather presenter. Geoffrey Robertson just left, you hear him. Now we go ahead. We give our thanks to the Minister of Tourism, Mrs. Elena Kountoura, who has granted us with her auspices. The London Greek Tourist Office for providing the gifts, the Messenian Society for providing the hotels, our friends Thomas Antoniadis of Critical Publics, Mrs. Athena Paris-Theofili, Mrs. Matti Egon-Xyla, Dr. Angelica Cabuni, a famous plastic surgeon in Harley Street. And Peter Strong from Oxford, our friend on the right, the Hellenic Bankers Association-UK, the Hellenic TV, who is filming tonight, and the London Greek Radio LGR 103.3 FM. Our speaker tonight, you have been waiting so long, is Dr. Michael Scott. He is a brilliant classical scholar, a vibrant personality, and an author on Greek and Roman ancient words. Michael is known to the wider public from his broadcasting work on radio and television, as well as Channel 4, the History Channel, National Geographic, Nova, SBS in Australia, ITV, as well for BBC 1, 2 and 4. Michael is well known for his work on Delphi, which began with his PhD leading to two books and to a documentary for BBC 4. In 2010, which has since been shown more than 20 times. And around the world, of course, he was made an honorary citizen of Delphi. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michael Scott. I better let you know that we have a few books, Delphi, in Greek and in English, if you are interested later. And we have only a few copies of his latest book, Ancient Words. And now also I want to tell you on your tables, there are some envelopes. This is for a charity that the Greek Press Association supports, and the charity is for poor children in Greece. Please, you can put there your, whatever you think is appropriate, and then there are some people here from the charity to collect the envelopes. Thank you very much indeed, Michael Scott.
Can we start by having a round of applause for the fantastic organisation and Mark of this evening? Αξιότιμες κυρίες, αξιότιμοι κυρίοι, καλησπέρα σας. It is a great pleasure for me to be here this evening to speak to you very briefly about Delphi. In the first century AD, 2,000 years ago, there was a meeting between two men. One was called Cleombrotus. He was stopping at Delphi on his way back from the Red Sea on his way to Sparta. And he met with another friend, Demetrius, who was on his way from Britain. Why anyone would want to go to Britain 2,000 years ago, I don't know. But on his way from Britain, all the way on his journey towards Tarsus in Asia Minor. This meeting is recorded for us in a dialogue by the writer Plutarch. And it is, for me, incredibly important for us to be able to understand why Delphi mattered in the ancient world and why Delphi continues to matter today. Just under a century before that meeting of Cleombrotus and Demetrius, another Greek writer, Strabo, told a story about why Delphi was where it was. Zeus, the king of the gods, released two eagles from opposite ends of the world, and the place where they met, the center of the world, the omphalos, was Delphi. Delphi was a critical meeting point in the globe. A little over 200 years before that, another man called Clearchus arrived at Delphi, having traveled all the way from the settlement of Iconium in Greco-Bactria, which is modern-day Afghanistan. He made that journey in order to write down the philosophical words of the oracle at Delphi that were inscribed onto the temple, and then returned back home again to inscribe those words on a monument in Greco-Bactria that survives to this day. What I think so many people miss about Delphi when thinking about it is not the oracle that we all may have heard of, or indeed the many fantastic monumental dedications that litter the site that we see when we go there as tourists, or indeed the stories of the fantastic games, the athletic and musical games that were held there that were on par with the Olympics. What people can too often miss is the fact that it was the combination of all these things that made Delphi a place to go to be seen, to meet with others, like Cleombrotus and Demetrius, like is told in the story of Strabo and his two eagles, or like Clearchus coming all the way from modern-day Afghanistan. Delphi was a crucial node in the ancient world map, and it's that which kept it going for over 1,000 years in antiquity, rather than any one of its individual functions. And I think it's that idea of Delphi as a meeting point, which is what has so inspired us and will continue to inspire us about Delphi going forward in the future. We come, of course, as tourists. It is the second most visited site in Greece after the Acropolis, with a little over, I think, 2 million tourists per year. My own first visit to Delphi, I was 17 years old on a school trip, as I'm sure many of you will have been taken on a school trip at some point to Delphi. It didn't start very well for me. My luggage had been lost on the plane on the way out there. I only had the clothes I was wearing, and it was the end of the trip. Not many people wanted to spend much time talking to me at Delphi, as they had done in centuries past. But when you go to Delphi, its power to pull people from around the world to see its great monuments, its ruins, is still very evident. When you go there, you hear every language under the sun. You meet people from around the world. It was a fact that David and I brought out in the BBC documentary about Delphi that we filmed. We used these modern visitors to stand in, if you like, for the ancient Demetrius, Cleombrotus, Clearchus, and others. But we come to Delphi too, and we've been talking about this just this evening, because it has, I hope you will all agree, an allure. There is something about being at Delphi that is, frankly, in my mind, like nowhere else on Earth. Perhaps it's the combination of the landscape and the built site. Perhaps it's the extraordinary views. Perhaps it's the stillness and the calm. But there is a sense of, is it spirituality? Is it calm? Is it a sense of our humanity that one gets at Delphi, I think, that you don't get anywhere else? But people also come to Delphi and keep coming and will keep coming because they have been inspired by this idea of the meeting point. And as they seek to change the future, they want to encapsulate its power. In 1977, the European Cultural Centre was opened at Delphi for the main purpose of reviving and continuing Delphi as a cultural and intellectual centre of Europe. And it has since hosted conferences on everything from multilateral security to ancient drama. In 1987, ICOMOS, when justifying Delphi's position as a World Heritage Site, said this, that its mission continues to bring together people otherwise divided by material interest. In 1995, the Hellenic Postal Service issued a set of commemorative stamps with the inscription Amphictyone, the governing body of Delphi, precursor of the United Nations. And in the 1990s, as part of the European Union border agreements, sets of walking paths were created that crossed those boundaries to symbolise our new freedom of movement. One of those paths, E4, was specifically sent through Delphi. And today, when you go to the site, you're greeted not just by a plethora of international flags, but also by the fact, I've always found extremely curious, that Delphi is twinned with a town in Japan. And in about a month's time, Delphi will play host to a new group of people who seek to be inspired by Delphi's role as a meeting point as they seek to change the future. And it's been fantastic this evening to meet people who will be going to that event, to the World Human Forum set in Delphi next month, and I look forward to being there as well as we seek, in our own small way, to change the future. Now, many people who come to Delphi with this idea of a meeting point have been inspired not just by the idea of people coming to Delphi from around the world, but that once they got there, they were somehow best friends. That everything else got put aside when they were at Delphi. That idea in the ICOMOS World Heritage Site justification document, that it brought together people otherwise divided by material interest. I'm a little uneasy about that idea, because frankly, you only need to scratch the surface of Delphi's ancient history, and you see that many of the people who came there did so in order to celebrate their victories over one another in battle, to compete with one another for the best monuments or for victories in the athletic and musical competitions, or to seek advice of the gods in order to win out over others. Not to recognize this element of Delphi's past, would be to do injustice to its history. But we should also remember that at the same time, Delphi was, as we've seen, the meeting place of friends, of philosophers, where ideas were born that would change the face of human existence, and where the very concept of humanity was discussed and exported again around the world. So all of this, for me, from celebrating military conquest to celebrating the occasional unity that brought the Greek world together, from vicious bouts of keeping up with the Joneses to discussing philosophy, all this was made possible and worthwhile because people came to Delphi in large numbers. And in that analysis, if we're honest with ourselves, I think Delphi does stack up as a kind of precursor to many of the international organizations with which it has been compared, as places that see both agreements and disagreements, as places that see both conflict and the blossoming of unity, as places that see competition as well as mutual aid, thanks purely to the fact that people show up. And perhaps in the years ahead, as we stare a new wave of isolationary European and global politics in the face, particularly as we sit here, as we've heard this evening, weeks away from pressing the Article 50 button, that message and model that Delphi offers will become even more important. Demetrius and Cleombrotus could meet a Delphi coming from Britain and the Red Sea, respectively, as could Clearchus coming from Iconium in modern-day Afghanistan. I'm not sure that if President Trump had been in charge, he would ever have been able to get there. Let us keep that Delphi in our mind, what was possible 2,500 years ago, as we seek to fashion the future for ourselves and for future generations.
Everyone, my name is Thanasis Gavos. I'm one of the members of the Greek Press and the Greek Press Association here in London. I want to thank Michael for honoring us with your presence, Michael, and your excellent talk, and for your contribution to Greece, both with your fine book on Delphi, and of course, all of your work. The association would like to give you a very small but very symbolic gift. So this is a baby cypress tree drawn from the seed of a coal coming from the ancient precinct of Delphi. Peter Strong got it. He has quite a few more with him when he's interested, but when everything is sorted out with the University of Warwick, the association would be delighted to send a handsome number of Delphic baby cypresses to plant on the extended new campus in Warwick. Okay, thank you very much.
From Oxford, he's our friend and member, the Associated, who would like to say a few words. Good evening. I'd like to say how much I enjoyed both of the speakers this evening and was really taken. But I'm speaking not as a lawyer able at determining the legal status of items pertaining to the past, and not as an historian able to put together, for your benefit, a wonderfully coherent picture of certain events of our shared past that lead to where we stand now. And I got great benefit from Michael Scott's book on Delphi, and I've read it through so thoroughly, more than probably I've read any other book. I'm speaking as an anthropologist who has an interest in both social and material culture, as well as in geopolitics and culture. That's my perspective. And it is one which tells me that we mustn't neglect to think as widely as we can about Greeks' plight in the world situation of today. Greece is not a comfort zone, a zone where everything surrounding it is stable and long-term pretty predictable. That's not where Greece is now, or indeed where the majority of the European community is now. People are trying to solve a difficulty in the middle of a problem, which includes the difficulty of the marbles. In my study of material culture over many years, one observation returns again and again. It is that people can admire and love the objects that others make much more than they can often love the others themselves. But loving the cultural objects of others is a start on the task of getting to love your neighbor. It is one idea that we should send our most precious artworks for our worst enemies to protect and cherish. We wouldn't drop bombs on them if they were holding our most precious objects. But maybe this kind thought no longer applies in the present cruel world. Not all cultures are quite so loving of others' cultures or art. So if we don't watch out, it is not inconceivable that even the Parthenon itself will risk the fate that the world has seen befalling Palmyra. It is this thought that concerns me even more than the location of the otherwise portable marbles, and also what of the classical antiquities in Anatolia. They are safe, of course, under the present Turkish leadership. However, should instability and fundamentalism arrive, our concerns must be raised. These nightmares mustn't be allowed to happen, but they are more likely if we keep our heads in the sand. The return of the marbles has to be a dream belonging to a situation of assured European stability, where the settling of such matters to the delight of Greeks would be like the icing on a cake. But we must ask, in the situation of today, how many productive jobs would be returned, would the returned objects provide? Pitifully few, if any. Are there not, in the circumstances, higher priorities for Greece, such as those that could bring it income, strengthen its status and alliances with other nations, and increase the chances of survival, of its chances of survival in an unsettled period of Europe's history? This is where Michael Scott's book on Delphi gives us a model for a practical way forward. Delphi provided a durable institution which brought people and states into intercommunication and relation, and somehow things continued for a very long time because of the structure. As Michael said, 1,000 years. The point I'm driving at here is that the Greek creation, that the Greek creation that Greeks need to be putting their efforts to is the task of repatriating the Olympic Games permanently to Greece. For has not Greece a greater moral claim to the Olympics as she has to any other of the creations of her ancestors? To do something big is necessary. Delphi is the inspiration. Unfortunately, because its geology and limitations of time, of space, there's not much you can do but actually keep it in its beautiful state as the most symbolic center in Greece. However, the business needs to be done further south at Olympia to actually get the economy functioning. Today, Greece floats precariously, abutting into areas of considerable instability. The stability of the European community is presently being threatened by forces from without and within. As we all know, Europe, including Greece, is attempting to cope with immense gunless invasions, which seem as yet to be far from over. These can be profoundly culturally altering. What about numbers of people? As an anthropologist, I have concluded that every culture is a system of coercion. Gather a group, and very soon that group will be tempted into imposing its ways, and thereby getting into agitation with another group preferring to impose its different ways. It's not that people are innately terrible, but that's just what cultures do. Numbers are very important. We can say that the battles of today and tomorrow are not really being fought and won on the fields of Mars, if I might bring a Roman in here, but on the bedsteads, by those groups who can produce the greatest number of souls to add to the new form of war, the gunless invasion. shutting our mouths on such subjects is an evasion. So therefore, I haven't shut my mouth this evening. It would be depressing if Greeks at home and abroad were not wide awake to the dangers of the situation and prepared to face facts with wisdom and courage. Greece needs the Olympics as a big project. As things stand, the Olympics have gone off track. They have become an ostentatious embarrassment around the world. The games, however loud and expensive, have really lost their way. So what is Greece going to do about this prodigal child of itself, the Olympics? Ignoring it and looking instead at an issue which is small by comparison. What might be a more constructive path to take which can bring more prosperity and more strength than presently is the case? Projects of the sort which provide jobs, projects which positively strengthen the country and grow its status. Go for the goals which have a possibility of prosperity attached to them. Unless Greece strengthens herself and her potential for alliances, much of what she presently possesses will be lost. That's all I have to say. Thank you.